Alright, hello everyone, and welcome to Star Trek Fenrir. For those who aren't in the know, Fenrir is a tabletop role-playing game using the Star Trek Adventures rule set. We normally are set in 2410 aboard a Cerberus class, but today is a little bit different. But before I talk about that, let me just say that if you want to catch the VODs of Season 1 of Fenrir, you can catch them on my YouTube and most of the popular podcast solutions like iTunes and Spotify. Now, today's session is, of course, a departure from our last 12 games, and that is because we are in the Mirror Universe. Now, those who aren't in the know, the Mirror Universe is sort of this parallel universe in Star Trek where all the evil and aggressive qualities have been ramped up to full cheese mode, and each and every one of my players will be playing as their mirror counterpart. As such, I expect maximum ham and no small amount of backstabbing. The good news is that even if they all die in a fire, we're still good to go for the official start of Season 2 next week. The other thing I have to say before I run the very last time we will see this particular intro is that whatever support you can provide the stream, whether it's just chatting in chat, bits, donations, sub, follow, whatever, I always greatly appreciate it. Just make sure to take care of yourselves first. And with that, let's go ahead and run the intro and dive right in. And welcome back. So normally I would have a player read something here to set the scene. Tonight I'll be doing that myself. So today we begin aboard the IKS Katorg, a proud Negvar class in the Klingon-Cardassian Alliance. Each and every one of the player characters has been captured for some reason or another, whether or not it was because you were part of the Resistance, or maybe you were just simply in the wrong place at the wrong time. Whatever the case may be, you now find yourselves in one of the many brigs aboard the Katorg, and if you don't break out soon and escape, it's very likely that you're going to be tortured and thrown in whatever penal service or colony suits the Katorg captain's fancy. So our first scene is, of course, in one of the brigs of the Katorg. Now, the brigs are currently separated into smaller rooms, and by that I mean that currently, Vassar and Archuleta, you are in one room, Williams and Lee, you are in another, and in between your rooms is a divider. Now, this divider is a half wall, so you can see perfectly fine into the adjacent cells, and what's stopping you from just hopping over is that there is a buzzing sort of electric fence that runs down the middle of this partition. Now, as far as the main doors into this place, they are currently sealed. They are made of transparent aluminum, so the guards standing outside, there are two for each cell, so there are four guards currently present. They can see through the transparent aluminum. And the other thing is that on both sides of the door are force fields. So you would have to get through not one, but two force fields if you wanted to break out of the main entrance. Now, the other thing I should say is that this is a Klingon brig. This is not a Federation brig, which means that the accoutrements, as it were, they're not very great. You're dealing with lots of, shall we say, smells and lots of unpleasant noise, because as far as I can tell, Klingon ships are all about the death metal in the background, as it were. But I thought, since we are all playing a one-shot character, we would take a few moments to talk about our characters. So I'm going to start with Williams, go to Lee, then to Archuleta, and then I'm going to let Dag go on his marvelous spiel about his outfit. So Williams, if you would take it away first, just tell us a little bit about your character. Don't have to tell us your secrets, just a little bit to get a feel for him.
Sure. William was actually born to a collaborator family, so his parents were on the side of the Klingon-Cardassian Alliance. He was sent to infiltrate a Terran resistance cell, but found a sense of belonging among his fellow humans that he never had before. Flipped and used his knowledge of the Klingon-Cardassian alliance against them. In the process, murdered his family, all except for a sister who is out to kill him.
Does the sister have a name?
You can feel free to give her one. I never did.
Noted. All right, up next, Mr. Lee.
Okay. Well, by way of introduction, Lee is standing off in the corner of the room, and he is using some kind of writing implement to scrawl on the sides of the cell. He is remarkably emaciated and disheveled. He has a tremendous scar along the side of his face. It looks as if the skin has been flayed off and then burned with a brand of some kind. His ear is missing. It's been torn off, it seems.
Left or right?
The right ear, where the Bajoran earring would normally have.
Okay.
And he is scrawling a combination of complex mathematical formulae and invectives laden with swears and curses against the prophets along the walls. And at the end of one of the complex lines of formulae, the final calculation is circled, and it leads up to this series of words: no more gods, no more wormhole, no more orbs.
I love it. Up next, we cut across the partition to look at Archuleta. Tell us a little bit about them, Watney.
Sure. So Bree in the Mirror Universe is a dyed-in-the-wool Terran Empire supporter. So counter to her prime self, her silver hair is short, messy. It looks almost singed at the ends. Her jaw has been replaced with a Borg augment, and above her left eye is a set of three deep scars. Her body is also heavily Borgified, but it doesn't seem to bother her too much. Currently in the cell, she's standing looking quite aggravated and pacing back and forth along the walls. And every so often she's looking at what the Bajoran is doing. And she doesn't seem bothered by her cellmate too much.
Question, in terms of Borgification, are we talking full limb replacement, partial limb replacement, organ replacement?
I would say organ replacement and at least two limbs.
At least two limbs. Okay. Left side, right side, does it matter?
It doesn't matter.
All right, let's say your left side, just for sake of argument.
Cool.
All right, and then last but not least, Mr. Dagg, tell us a little bit about Mira Vassar. You're muted.
Stupid vocal processes. Mirror Vassar began existence as a virulent AI program that was deployed to infiltrate and take over a Borg cube to use for the Terran resistance. The Borg were able to initiate a self-destruct, and in order to escape, the AI found the closest non-assimilated but to be assimilated body, which happened to be a Vulcan, and downloaded itself into that Vulcan by way of the assimilation process, which are these nanites that are virulently trying to assimilate the body. Vassar escaped that cube with Archuleta, and they have been fighting the good fight ever since. Terran Empire.
Love it. All right. Matic will be joining us at a dramatically appropriate moment in the future. But for the time being, you all are in the cell. And to start things off, Williams, one of the guards kind of looks in at the cell and whispers to his fellow, "Hey, is that the guy we took the ship from?" "Yeah, that's him. We're going to totally tear his ship apart, strip it down to parts. I don't know where the hell he might have gotten the thing in the first place."
Well, Williams completely ignores their comments. Instead, approaches Lee and sort of disdainfully looks him over and says, "I know you."
Lee would ignore him completely, as he is intensely fixated on the last series of calculations on that that wall.
Yeah. So as he's doing that, for the guys in the other cell, You can see Williams becomes very visibly agitated at being ignored and shoves Lee. Says, hey.
What?
I'm talking to you.
You don't understand. The bilitrium explosion, all we have to do is calibrate it in order to inverse the polarity of the aperture of the wormhole. And then, in a static warp field, we can...
I know all about the bilitrium, dumbass. I sold it to you.
Williams? Is that you?
Yeah.
You have to get me the bilitrium. It's all that we need. We can lock the wormhole in a state of quantum superimposition. It will be as if two quantum phase states have entered into flux. The wormhole will be open and closed at the same time. Not even the prophets, the wormhole aliens, will be able to open it again. It will be stuck. There's no more gods, no more prophets, no more orbs, no more orb of pain, no more orb of madness, no more.
And there's a Williams big bang.
Shut him up.
Yeah, I'd say there's a big bang on the door from the outside, or at least on the wall, and one of the Becks shouts in, hey, crazy man, keep it the hell down.
And Williams just sort of looks up at the guard thing. Oh yeah, tough guy from behind a force field, or a door, whatever.
The Klingon does sort of, you know, straighten up a little bit and, you know, sneers at you and says, I could take a puny man like you in my sleep.
Bree looks between them and she's like, yeah, yeah, he probably could.
Always a pleasure, Corporal.
She looks to Lee and says, don't let him push you around. You're just pissed that his ship is in the hands of Klingons.
They better not touch my ship. I'm telling you right now, if they do, I will kill every single Klingon on this ship with my bare hands, I swear.
Yes, that would be very effective.
But Lee,
and highly unlikely.
I don't remember asking you a goddamn thing, program.
And it's just then, as that little bit of awkwardness floats in, there's a commotion outside. And in step, another four guards, two of them each carrying an individual. One of them is a character I think you all know and love, is a certain gentleman who looks like he's been beaten high hell and back and is thrown into Lee's and Williams's cell. Now, this is not Ensign Jensen. This is Ensign Thomas, his cousin.
Oh, what?
So Thomas, for those who don't know what Jensen looks like, Thomas... a little bit scraggy hair, maybe a half beard going on. Very lithe, very trim. Basically looks like if Barkley was a little bit more of a bubble boy, if that makes any sense. But he's thrown into Lee's and Williams' cell. And then on the other cell, a gentleman that I'm going to let Matic describe what is thrown into Vassar's and Archuleta's cell.
So, what comes through the door is a fully sentient Borg. It's Matic. Back whenever his ship got ambushed years and years and years ago, except now he's from being a Borg under Victus. He later found sentience after Savia went from this universe to the Prime Universe, and he looks similar to, he looks slightly more advanced than other Borg that would be around this time. Okay. He seems to have a more refined and sleek look to him, as opposed to the clunkiness of the Borg that are around in this time frame.
So sort of like, I can't remember the name of the episode, but the one episode of Voyager where the Borg take over the Doctor's holo projector and make the whole...
Yeah.
Yeah.
They make the more futuristic-based Borg.
Okay. I can dig it. But yeah, force fields are lowered, doors are opened, you're thrown in, and immediately the force fields and doors come right back up.
Is your character Matic injured at all? Can we tell?
Any injuries that would have occurred? No, there's no physical characteristics that he's injured. Okay. But he does have sort of like that blank bored stare. Okay. And it is looking directly at you, Captain, or looking at you, Archuleta.
Okay, she's just gonna stare back.
It's a real techno fetishist club over there, isn't it?
Also, Dag, you're muted again.
Vassar is feeling along the walls for trying to sense any power fluctuations in the wall that can be exploited. Basically just getting a sense of how the cell runs, not intending to exploit them immediately.
All right, why don't you roll me a insight and engineering difficulty of 3. Now, what I would say is that momentum is possible in a Mirrorverse game, but I've gone ahead and done you all the courtesy of not starting with threat. So I have no threat right now. So just going to throw that out there.
Nobody give him threat for any reason.
Can't make any promises.
Cybersecurity. No, that's fine.
I'll give it to you for reasons that will become apparent. All right, so that is only 2 successes, so it will succeed at cost, but I'm going to take 2 threat. So, Vassar, as you kind of run a hand over one of the walls, let's say the back left corner, you sense that the shielding in this brig cell is not sufficient, as if they used either just not a long enough sheet of metal, or maybe the metal is not of the right alloy. Whatever the case may be, you're able to sense that there is a powered EPS conduit right behind where this corner, you know, kind of meets, that you could potentially maybe get at.
Good to know.
Then it is...
I'll walk over and rejoin. Is it Colonel or Corporal?
What did you have? What did you say?
I thought it was Colonel.
No, ELH. I'm sorry. What did you say?
What I was going to say is, does this turn into a 3-way Mexican standoff stare?
No, or... what did you say earlier? Was it Colonel?
Oh, let me check my notes. I think
because I changed it, but if it's back. Okay, Corporal. We'll say Corporal.
Corporal Archuleta, there appears to be a weakness that we can exploit. I believe I can access a nearby EPS conduit.
That's great. But they're going to see us do that. So.
I may be able to use the nanites in this host.
She narrows her eyes skeptically.
I'm a virus. It's what I do. Lay off the grindy.
Fine. Well, do what you're going to do.
I'm going to go take a nap over in that corner.
Okay.
And I'll put my hand against the wall and try to do some assimilation stuff.
Ooh. All right. We'll roll for that in a second. While that's going on, we go to the other cell where Ensign Thomas is finally picking himself off the floor. And something I neglected to say is that Ensign Thomas is in full Terran Empire getup, which means he has the, well, at least in this time period, the old style Terran uniform. So he's got sort of that, it's not a sweater vest, but it's, you know, sleeveless sort of shirt, got the sash going on. There was a knife on his belt that is now gone. But Ensign Thomas starts to pick himself up and go, who the hell are you people?
Williams.
Lee. Are you all right?
No, I'm not all right. They took my knife.
You let them.
I point to my face. I think that might be the least of your concerns at this moment, but I guess we all have our different priorities.
Wait. You're telling me they took your ear?
And most of my face, yes. Yes.
He turns almost 180 on the spot, goes over to where the force field is, and just starts pounding on it and says, "Let me out! Let me out of here, you freaking maniacs!" Basically right, having a panic attack.
Right. So Williams is just going to come over here to Anson Thomas. And, he's going to come over there. And I'm going to just sort of spin him around and give him a real hard slap across the face.
Mm-hmm. Backhand or forehand?
Forehand.
Okay.
And just sort of shake him and say, "You need to get a hold of yourself, man. You're a Terran."
And he takes the smack well and it goes, "Oh, I went the wrong way with the slap," but you know what I mean. Right. Takes the slap and he goes, "You're right. You're right. I've spent far too many hours in the torture chambers." Or, no, they're not called torture chambers. What the hell? How hard did you hit me, man?
Agonizers?
Yeah, those.
Not hard enough. The agony booth. You're talking about the agony booth.
Yeah. Why did I not remember that?
Yeah, congrats, you're freaking late. You spent some time in the agony booth. Who hasn't?
And, actually, he, Ensign Thomas, there's a moment where his back is to the guards, but both Williams, Lee, and I guess anyone in the other cell that's paying attention, the fearful face drops for just a second, and Ensign Thomas winks. And then he goes back to, "Oh, God, maybe I spent too many times in the agony booth. My memory's going, man."
Right. Welcome to our little circle of suffering.
Lee will get a little bit closer to him, and I'd like to try to perform a kind of cursory medical examination of him. Is there anything that stands out as being unusual about him physically, or does he show any signs of injuries beyond that which we would expect from rough treatment from the Klingon guards?
Roll me a reason medicine, difficulty of one.
I will use my augmented ability reason then.
Okay.
Focus.
Survey says that is three successes, so you get two momentum. So most of Thomas's wounds are superficial. Extremely superficial. In fact, you're pretty sure that one bruise on his left cheek, pretty sure that's makeup.
Well, they didn't treat you nearly as badly as they did me. I see.
And Thomas just sort of looks at you and doesn't know what to say.
Yeah, Lee, what is it?
Do you know him? I mean, can you trust him?
Williams just sort of looks him up and down. No, I don't know him. And as a further point, if I don't know you, I don't trust you.
Meanwhile, in the other cell, Mr. Vassar, you're doing nanomachines, if I understand correctly. Let's see, I'm trying to think what would be a good role for this. Why don't you do a control and a medicine for this one? I think control medicine would be a good role. Difficulty of 4. So you may wish to spend momentum and give me threat.
Do it.
You said a control.
And medicine. And as a reminder, since it's been a while, it is one momentum or one threat for 3 dice total. It is 3 momentum or 3 threat for 4 dice total. And if you want to go all the way, so you're rolling five dice, that is six momentum or threat. And you can interchange, so you could give me one threat and two momentum. You could give me two threat and one momentum. Or you could just roll straight and see if you crit.
Okay, so Vassar wants to set up a remote timer on the EPS relay to have it blow on command.
Okay.
Basically. So use the nanites to assimilate the local area to produce a remote timer that can be neuro-connected detonated.
Okay.
With that said, how'd you guys like to give away six threat?
You have a value you could tap.
I think that's a fantastic.
What's the limit? There's
there is no limit on threat.
The limit does not exist.
All right. So okay. you said control medicine.
Mm-hmm.
And so that gives me a default of five. If you give me
six threat, you may roll five dice. Yes.
And then cybersecurity.
No. Yeah, I'll give you it.
Cool.
In before complications.
In before all fails.
Hey, so that is four successes, which is exactly what you needed. So yes, what I would say, Vassar, is that the good news is that you are able to set up this remote sort of connection to explode, implode, whatever you want to do with the EPS conduit. Your nanomachines have facilitated your request. And it is a link to you currently. If you want to expand that link to someone else, you may do so. But sort of your nanomachines report back that all has been taken care of.
I'm going to take a nap.
Okay.
Fleshy thing doesn't work right.
So what is our most recently added Borg doing? Standing there still?
His eyes have adjusted over to Vassar, and he's taking a couple steps towards Vassar, but he doesn't really seem like he's all there.
Okay. So Bree is curious. She's going to see him stepping towards Vassar and move that way as well. And he might stop, but she keeps going and stands right in front of him. And she's just going to kind of look him up and down. And can I make a roll to see if I recognize the better technology
at all? Why don't you roll me a insight, and I would give you engineering, or I would give you command.
Okay.
And difficulty on this is just a one. Interesting. So I'm going to take threat. I'm up to 10.
Oh, God.
So, I would say that, you could tell this is definitely upgraded Borg tech. He's done some work on himself. Whether or not it is from the future or not, I leave to Maddox's discretion.
He will look at Brian. Your technology. You do not serve the collective as we do.
You're damn right I don't. Go ahead.
Was it voluntary? I know that it is common for warriors to enhance themselves, or did your people lose to us?
We, and when I say we, I mean my friend and I over here, purposefully infiltrated and assimilated ourselves.
Yes, yes, we're all Borg. Woo.
Well, he's the most Borg, so.
Oh, it's a competition now.
Not really. She's going to lean over and look at the Klingon guard through the transparent aluminum, and she's going to spit on the glass.
Okay.
Spit on it.
So your spit hits the force field and fizzles out, and the Klingon back just sort of turns and looks at you questioning, like, what? But it is at this moment that I'm going to spend 2 threat to make something happen. So what happens is twofold. First, and this is going to be a chain of events, so we're going to take it one step at a time. First thing that happens, Thomas, once again, the facade drops. He looks specifically at Williams and says, duck in 3, 2, 1. And then Thomas ducks. Do you duck, Williams?
Duck.
All right. Lee, the good news is that you don't need to duck. But for those near the door, what happens is on that side of the cell, there is the shearing sound of metal on metal. And moments later, a ceiling tile rips off from the ceiling and slams into the force field with enough force that it knocks out the force field. And with it, a good chunk of the door. At the same time, Vassar, your nanites are reporting that there is an overload in the EPS conduit. It is not the overload you had set up, but it is an overload nonetheless. Now, you do have control over the EPS conduit, so I leave it to your discretion whether you stop the overload, let it happen, channel it elsewhere. You're muted.
I'll definitely channel it as close as I can to the force field emitters that are holding us inside this cell and separating our two cells. And I'm going to roll the heck away from it and stand next to Archuleta and our new Borg guy friend.
Okay. So as Thomas and Williams are dealing with ceiling tiles from hell, a explosion literally rockets out from the metal walls of the cell. And impacts the hollow, or not the hollow emitters, the force field emitters of the second cell. And, you know, the force fields are meant to keep in inmates. They're not meant to keep in an EPS explosion. And they are very quickly overwhelmed, as is the door. So essentially, once this has all happened, part two of this is that you all now essentially can get outside and attack the guards. Now, part of this is the guards aren't just going to sit there and let this happen. They have already gone ahead and pulled out of their back or pulled off their back. They have pulled out batlets and are getting ready to assault you all. So we are going to go into initiative order here. And as a reminder, in ground combat, you get a minor action and a full action. And there is a list of it. I will get you the page number for it in a moment. But it works pretty much the same way as every other combat. It goes player, enemy. You know, just bouncing back and forth like that. And it's really up to you all who would like to act first. So I simply leave that determination to you all. As I pull up the page for you.
May I?
Please.
All right. So Williams is going to bolt past Thomas to this Klingon Beck. And I am going to attempt to get that batleth away from him.
Okay. So this is going to be an opposed daring and security difficulty of 1. And you need to get at least 2 successes on this one.
Do we have any momentum?
You have 2.
I'm going to spend 1 point of momentum.
3 successes. You get that momentum right back. And you may... I would say you have 2 options here. You can either do damage, and if you do enough of it, you will knock him down with such force that you can just kind of snatch the batleth out of the air. Or you can simply just take the batleth from him, doing no damage.
I will just take a look here.
Also, I found the page. It starts on page 172 if you want to see what actions you have available.
I will just, for now, I will attempt to do damage, actually.
Okay, so then that's going to be your unarmed damage, which is 6 challenge dice, I believe.
6 challenge dice.
Okay. Now, very key distinction here. Are you being lethal or non-lethal?
Lethal.
Okay, so I get a point of threat.
Yeah.
And the good news is because you nominated it as lethal, it bypasses the non-lethal resistance of the Klingon. And yeah, you give him such a, punch, roundhouse?
Throat punch.
Throat punch. You punch his throat so hard that his trachea collapses inward. Holy and he kind of, he loses grip of the batleth and just goes and falls to the ground spasming. But you now have a batleth, which I believe is a grand total of, let me look up those stats.
It's,
I have them here.
It's 8. It's 8 challenge dice.
Yep.
With my modifier, and it's vicious 1, I believe.
It is indeed.
Nice. So that's Williams's action, but I do have the quick action talent, so we can retain the initiative for free.
Excellent. So one of you may act again.
Whoever wants to do that.
Looks like Dag's vocal processors are still out.
Are there any live power lines that are exposed from the explosion that could be thrust at either metal grating that would electrocute them or at one of them themselves?
Okay. I will say for sake of argument that the explosion has exposed enough conduit that you could accomplish this.
All right. Stupid primary protected directive. Got to keep Archuleta safe. I hate this, but I'm going to do it anyway.
It's not bitter at all.
I will grab a safe hand of this conduit and hold it in front of me, leaping at the Klingon in front of our cell.
All right, so again, it's going to be a daring security, difficulty of 1. I am going to spend 1 of my threat so that the Beck is rolling 3 dice.
We'll spend, we have 1 last momentum here.
Do it. Do okay. it. We got to get out of these cells.
Yep, and you need at least 3 successes here. I believe. You could spend threat. Can give me threat, just as a reminder.
Let's see. I spend the momentum, I get 3 dice. And to get an extra dice would be another threat?
2 threat.
Does determination exist?
It does. If you want to use determination, you can.
I'm not technically the captain, but can I give it to this guy?
I mean, you could. I would maybe recommend...
Can I do something special with determination, or is that not...
You part of your captain ability is you can give out your determination.
Okay.
Would I be able to twist my value, the needs of the many, to be protect Archuleta as a subroutine?
Sure. Now, okay. That would give you a grand total of 2 successes to start off with, but it would make your third dice a momentum and a threat.
Okay.
So we only need to see 1 more success on your 3 rolls here.
Right. And of course, I am not a... would a xenobiology focus to be able to thrust this in the right spot on a Klingon's body to weaken the organs?
I love it.
Now you're thinking right. Like Matic.
Mm-hmm.
Here we go.
Very nice. That is an extremely good roll. So that is a grand total of 5 successes, which means you get 2 momentum back on that. Now, because you're using a conduit and not using like your actual fists, I'm going to treat this like a grenade. So I believe grenades are what, 4 challenge dice? Let's take a look real quick here. Yes, grenades are indeed 4 challenge dice. So go ahead and roll me 5 challenge dice if you could. So one more. Okay. Would you like to spend a momentum or a threat to reroll those zeros?
Yeah, I'll drop a momentum on that. So it's 3.
Mm-hmm. 3. Well, 4, because you have 4 zeros, at least as far as I can see. That is a significant amount of successes. So with that many successes, you rush forward with this conduit. I feel like I saw this in a Terminator movie somewhere, but you rush forward with the conduit and you shove the live end into his sternum. And based on your medical knowledge of a Klingon, you know just the right angle to get in at his second heart. So that as the first heart literally explodes or implodes within him from the electric current running through him, the second one goes into overdrive and the blood begins to pour out of this Beck's mouth as he spasms on the spot as if he's having a seizure. And then he goes down hard. And for the moment, you all are not in combat, but I'm going to keep the turn order up just in case you pause too long here.
Do I get a part action here?
Sure.
Can I swipe that batleth from him as he goes down?
You certainly can.
Okay.
Do they have any other weapons?
Well, if you come out and search him, what you will find is that each of the guards has one disruptor. So there are 2 batleths and 2 disruptors on the field.
No duck togs?
No, interestingly enough, they are not carrying the togs.
I'll pick up a disruptor, if that's all right.
I don't know what I'm going to do with this, but I'll keep it. It'll probably come in handy.
Yeah. Do they also carry their disruptors, GM?
Yeah, yeah. They each have a disruptor pistol.
Yeah, I'm good. Want one of those two.
I assume when we were captured, we don't have our weapons.
No, unfortunately not.
We don't know where they're at either.
Unfortunately, no.
Okay.
But you are now out of your cell, which opens up a realm of possibilities.
I would like to check for surveillance equipment and a control console of any kind.
Roll me a insight security, please. Difficulty of 1.
Cybersecurity?
Yeah, that would definitely apply now. I will let this succeed at cost, so I will get 2 more threat. So what you find is actually right outside the cells themselves, in sort of that antechamber, there is a console against where the partition starts between the 2 cells. That is behind an opaque wall, so they can see. It's sort of like a one-way mirror. They can see into the cell, but you can't see out. But it's sort of right at the crux of that T, where the console is, and it takes you maybe a few button pushes to get in. They're Klingons. They don't have great cybersecurity.
I want to do 2 things. I want 1 to try and put any cameras on a loop.
Okay.
And then the next thing I would do is bring up schematics for the ship that would lead us back to William's impounded vessel.
Okay. So what I would say is you're able to put the cameras on a loop. You are able to pull up a blueprint of the Negvar. And you are also able to pinpoint a direct route to William's ship. However, there is a problem. Several problems, actually. The first is that there is a captain level lockout on the cargo bay that is currently holding Williams's shuttle.
There it is.
The second is that apparently the ship is under attack. And you know this because the weapon systems are charged and discharging. The shields are up. And pretty much every once in a while, you feel the ship sort of jostle.
Can I tell if the captain level lock is biometric, verbal?
It is biometric, meaning that you have to be the captain within reason.
Dead or alive.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And would there be any ability for me to establish a neurologic connection with the Negvar's mate computer?
I would say it is possible, but you would have to spend some time here to do so.
Well, let's assess. Corporal, I've got a beeline on William's ship. It's protected. The captain locked it out, so we need his body, alive or dead, to unlock it and get the heck off of here before whoever's attacking us blows us to smithereens.
Okay. Well, if we can't get in there without him, then let's just find him. And you keep what you kill, right?
He is no doubt on the bridge.
All right.
There is an alternative.
I'm all ears, drone.
Literally.
If we happen to go to their engineering, we could adjust power and shielding to where the rest of the ship goes. The command lockouts get taken out, and then adjust the shielding to just be around the manned ship. They'll think they destroyed everything. They won't have reason to stick around. We have a free getaway.
I could save us a trip to engineering if you would be so kind as to dose me with some nanoprobes. I can establish a neurologic connection with the ship's computer.
It seems that during some experimentation the Klingons were doing, my nanoprobes have neglected to perform at full capacity at this time.
Assimilation dysfunction. Everybody gets it. It's nothing to be ashamed of.
I like this new snappy dag. It's really nice.
So do Sorry, we please. Know that the ship that we're on, what's it called? The Negmar?
It is
the Negvar class.
It Negvar. Is the Katorg.
The IKS okay. Katorg.
So the Katorg is under fire. Is that correct?
Yes.
And you said we all can feel it because the ship jostles.
Mm-hmm.
And if you listen closely, you can hear the weapons discharging.
Okay. Can we pick up the signature of who's firing on the ship?
That would require greater computer access than what you have currently.
We need enough. To spend time, and given that these cameras are on a loop, it may only take a few more minutes for whoever's outside these doors to come on in.
Well, why don't we invite the other ship's crew on?
If we could find a way to lower the shields.
If I may, we could create some kind of recursive algorithm to disrupt power functions to the shields. It wouldn't be that difficult to find a secondary power relay rather than trying to storm engineering or something like that. I'm certain that we could come up with some kind of recursive algorithm or... did I say that already?
Sometimes I can't tell if he's trying to blow up a wormhole or lower shields.
Yes, we could lower the shields, and then by disrupting the power functions on the vessel, right, we would be able to abscond with the, what was this, Commander Williams' shuttlecraft, was that? All we need to do is lower the defensive shielding in that area of the ship.
Well, we've probably got about 60 seconds left, so let's make a decision quick before we're all green splatters on the floor.
Well, perhaps we should just consider this conversation somewhere else then.
That's the best idea you've had all week.
And so Tom has his up his hand.
And
you.
Taryn?
Is he supposed to be doing that? And he points at the Borg that Williams took care of. And what you notice is that the Klingon has, of course, gone limp on the ground, but out of his mouth are coming what appear to be spider legs, like big old spider legs.
I'm gonna blast it with the disruptor until it goes away.
Okay, you discharge the disruptor into the Klingon until it is no longer head.
All right, all right.
What color were the legs?
Black, jet black. Just okay. Like my soul.
Are we in the Lovecraft episode still? Oh.
Wolf knows no boundaries.
Well, I mean, I just want my ship.
All right, we need to get to the bridge. And from the bridge, we can probably access an engineering console that will disrupt the shields and create havoc for everybody else on board. We'll be able to co-opt the transporters and maybe beam through this field, or we can take the captain's head and use the biometric sensors to get past whatever shielding he's put up.
I like option two.
Yeah, ditto.
All right. So as you all start to leave, Mr. Lee, I'd like you to roll me a reason medicine, please.
Okay.
Difficulty of one. Actually, it would be difficulty two because of how Vassar dealt with the remaining Klingon body.
And I don't suppose infectious diseases would apply as a focus here.
I'll give it to you for reasons that may become apparent.
And I'll use my augmented ability reason as well.
Okay. One moment, one success, I will take the two threat. Lee, you're familiar with bluegills, yeah? Let's just say that the spider entity appears to be some form of mirrorverse equivalent of bluegill.
My. What was it? Archuleta? Yes?
Yeah?
I believe we're dealing with something vastly more complex than we realize. These Klingons aren't Klingons at all. They're host to some form of parasitic life form. I believe this arachnid creature that emerged from the Beck's mouth was, I don't know, controlling him in some way. We may in fact be under attack by other Klingons or Alliance forces. This is a marvelous weapon. We should. I wish you hadn't destroyed that. We could have used that as a sample.
You want to take the one out of this one?
Yes, yes. You just have that ridiculous bat left on a duck tug. I can't cut him open.
I will try to cut off the Klingon's head with the bat left.
Roll me a...
Just to be extra gross, Williams is going to hold the head in place so that you could just get a clean chop.
Oh, God.
Just like the old times.
So roll me a daring security. The difficulty is one.
Is don't roll a complication. Really
please don't chop me with the bat.
Yeah, I would say don't roll a complication, otherwise you're hitting Williams.
So can I argue for a daring medicine as he's not really fighting back?
You do need to know where to cut on a Klingon neck. I'll give it to you. A daring medicine.
Take out the surgical batleth.
Size of a scalpel.
I've already used xenobiology, but I'm going to ask anyway.
You can use it. Go for it.
Williams gets an assist here, right?
Williams gets to morally assist.
Oh, my God.
All right, so you get two momentum, and yeah, you chop off that head. And because I find it macabre, as you pull up the head, dead spider legs dangle out of the hole.
Perfect.
Pick
the head up by the hair and toss it to Lee.
Yes, that's most effective. Okay. Can I attempt to examine it or to remove the arachnid creature?
Again, not going into gory detail. If you reach into the hole and do a little tug, you now have a little spider thing that's very much dead. It's maybe about the size of maybe an iPhone. Maybe about the size of that. Let's say the iPhone XS, because I know the size of that off the top of my head.
I'd like to find some kind of container, maybe just like wrap it up in one of the Klingon shirts.
Should have left it in the head.
Yes, that would have been an excellent carrying
Thomas comes
container.
Over and goes, okay, all right. God, I think it's going to... And just vomits all over you, Lee. Just all over you.
They always smell like that, dead or alive.
Oh God, it's not the smell. It's that came out of his... Oh God. Okay, here. And he just rips his shirt, like, you know, Kirk style, just rips his shirt, hands you part of the cloth.
Oh, thank you, yes.
You know you
yes.
had a sash, right?
Fuck.
What is it about Terran officers and trying to rip their shirts?
It's a tradition. Whatever the hell you are.
Yeah.
Do we maybe want to get out of here?
He's like, it's true.
We're not going to get anywhere unless we get out of here. So can we...
Sounds like a bug hunt.
Let's expedite.
Yes, yes.
All right. So as you step out of the brig, you emerge not into a corridor, but into a large catwalk or series of catwalks. And I have good news and I have bad news. The good news is that when you step outside, you are not immediately assaulted. The bad news is that there is very little cover to be had here, which means that the Klingons that are at the far end of these catwalks, based on your directions that you were able to pull up, Vassar, they are between you and what are essentially Klingon turbolifts.
Have they seen us?
Again, there's no cover, so when the door opens, they just kind of look over in your direction and go for their weapons. And I don't think there's going to be an easy way for me to show this for stream, but I'm going to do my best. But yeah, we are going to go right back into combat, and I'm going to say that the Beck are going to get their first turn. So, Beck number one pulls out his disruptor pistol, is just going to fire it at, let's say, Archuleta. Why not? Archuleta, you are struck by the disruptor pistol for 5 damage, which is a problem because that is an injury. So there's a few ways we can handle this. The first is that you can give me 2 momentum or 2 threat. And you'll still take the 5 damage, but you're not injured. The other option is you could use your determination, but your determination is kind of a trap option. And by that I mean is if you spend your determination to stay up and you take another injury, you're dead. But if you give me the momentum or threat, you just, you know, you still are injured, but you're not like determination screwed, if that makes any sense.
Mm-hmm.
Give him threat.
I'll take the former.
Okay. Are you going to give me the 2 momentum or the 2 threat?
How much momentum do we have?
3.
I'll give you threat.
Alrighty.
There you go.
So yeah, Archuleta, the disruptor pistol, the green beam hits you right in the left shoulder, which is a good thing because, again, we established the left side of your body is Borg. So the Borg... The Borg implants do take the brunt of the hit, but you still felt that one.
Yeah, she's gonna fall back a bit as it hits her and kind of just brace herself a little bit. But yeah. She's gonna make sure she has her own disruptor in her hand too.
Williams is gonna quip. So I see you didn't get any more savvy.
Nice.
I couldn't have stopped that one.
I'm going to push you off this fucking catwalk if you don't start shooting. Stop running your mouth.
Yeah. So what I would say is that I have Lee. We haven't known his name yet, but Tempest or Archuleta, one of you three can go.
Payback.
I'll go.
All right.
Unless you wanted to, Maddox.
I'm good. You can go ahead.
Okay, I'll go and you can go after me. So I'm going to fire at the one on the left.
One on the left. Okay.
Yeah. Can I mark that?
That's going to be a control security difficulty of 2.
Wee.
Also, Shizno in chat, no, they already used quick to action, and I'm treating this like just an extension of the previous combat.
I don't think I have a focus.
So. Yeah, you would need handheld energy weapons for this one.
Shizno, thanks for pulling for me.
Yeah. What I would say is I will allow you to hit him, but I am going to take the 2 threat.
Okay, why not? We'll just take all the threats.
Sure. All right, so you're going to roll me a disruptor damage, which is going to be, I believe, 3 plus your security, so 6 challenge die. Okay, and actually, because you have vicious 1 on that, that is more than sufficient to fire back. And this time, when you hit him... he goes down hard, and by hard, I mean he literally has a hole where his, well, hearts were. He's dead. He's very dead.
Nice.
But because I have all this lovely threat just sitting around, what I'm going to do is I'm going to spend 2 of it to bring in 2 more Becks from a little bit closer to you on the catwalks. And one of them is going to spend his turn running up to the person in front, which just happens to be Mr. Williams. So, Williams, I need you to go batleth to batleth with this Klingon Beck. And you just need to roll 1 success on this one. Literally, right, 1 success.
Perfect. It's daring security. Live dangerously and not spend any momentum on this.
And you get the 1 success. Yes. So you have, again, the option of disarming. You have the option of actually
damaging. No, I'm going to kill him.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to kill this one, too.
Vicious. Right.
And, yep, I believe I get to roll.
Yep, I believe it's 8 challenge die for you.
Dice, so let's do this.
All right, that is 6, which, again, is enough to put this guy down. So how does he go down?
I think rather than, like, you know, kill him with the actual bat lift, what Williams will do is sort of do that thing that Dax was very fond of and sort of sweep the leg with it, but use that to knock him off the catwalk.
Okay. So he does sort of scream all the way down. You don't hear a thump, but he is no more. And we now turn to either Lee or Tempest.
Tempest will look at Vassar. Transporter rooms. Where were they located? He'll reach over and turn on his vocal processor.
There's 1 3 decks up, 1 on the bridge, and 1 5 decks down.
Okay. He'll reach over and pull the disruptor. Williams, do you have the disruptor in your hand, or is it like
it's on
in
my,
like a holster?
Yeah, it's on my. We'll say it's on my belt because I'm holding the batleth right now. It's 2-handed, so.
Tempest will reach over, grab the pistol out of Williams's side, and then shoot the Beck right there closest to him.
Okay. Daring's or control security difficulty of 2.
Alien technology?
You would, sure.
You act
power
surprised.
Systems of the mirror universe.
We also made Dag do a little spit take. I love it.
It's a power systems check.
I'll do 1 momentum for an extra dice.
All right. Ooh. Mm. Ooh, this is interesting. I'm going to keep the complication. And what happens is, Tempest, as you pull the disruptor pistol out, it's already firing when you pull it out. And apparently, the Beck that had it before had this thing set to area. So, Matic, I need you to roll me 7 challenge die, please. All right, so that is a grand total of 6 damage to everyone. So we now have come to that again situation of, as you all are hit by this disruptor discharging in an area, and again, you're grouped very tightly, I need to know how everyone is staying up, if you're staying up. You can, of course, choose to go down, and what that would mean is you are out of combat. You cannot be targeted unless I spend threat. But it does mean that you will require medical attention. Whereas if you stay up and you win the combat, all you have to do is switch scenes and you get your health back. It's not a big deal. So we'll start with Archuleta again. You're down to, I believe, 1 stress remaining. How are you staying up this time?
So on page 172, can I drop prone?
You can.
Is that gonna make me dodge it? Oh, okay, okay. There's no cover.
Unfortunately not.
So it hits us.
Yeah,
so,
it definitely hits you.
I mean, if I take the damage, that's it, right? Like,
I mean, you would go down to 1 stress, but you could still be up. You would just have to either give me 2 threat or 2 momentum.
Oh, okay. Take some threat.
All right, we'll take the threat. Vassar, your fleshy body is getting hit. How are you staying up?
So I didn't include this in the backstory for Vassar, but he finds pain to be the greatest thrill of all time.
Ah, he's a masochist.
Down.
I love it.
He's going down.
Okay.
He's writhing in ecstasy, which should be agony, but it's not.
The agony and the ecstasy.
All right. So, Vassar, I'm just going to go ahead and take you out of the turn order. Again, you cannot be targeted unless I spend threat.
Gotta get rid of that threat, baby.
Yup. Next, we go to Williams. Williams, how are you staying up, if you're staying up?
I am. Take the 2 momentum.
Okay. And then, Mr. Lee Tobin, are you staying up?
Yes, I think I'll... could I spend 1 momentum and 1 threat?
You certainly can.
And that's what I'll do.
And Lee, remember how we had a discussion sidebar about certain Paw Wraith's abilities? Let's just say I'm spending 2 threat that you feel slighted by the fact you just got shot at point-blank range in the back.
What?
But it is either Lee's turn or Tempest's. Well, Tempest just went, so I guess it's the Beck. So the Beck just sort of sees Tempest shoot everyone in the back and goes, ha, they shoot themselves, stupid Terrans. And the Beck is actually just going to kind of walk over and is going to go at Williams with his Batleth again. They don't seem to learn. So Williams, I need at least 2 successes on this one.
Sorry, stupid Klingons. It's time to go. Take 1 point of threat, GM, because I'm going to get an extra die.
Alrighty. I believe. Hey, look at that. You get the 3 you needed. He going over the edge, too?
Oh, yeah.
So in a comedy of errors, he runs over, gets thrown off the edge. Another one runs over. He gets thrown off the edge. So that's, I think that's 3, at least by my count, that Williams has killed. It's rather impressive. However, we now come to Lee Tobin's turn, and I'm going to let Lovecraft play it out as he sees fit.
Throughout this entire exchange, Lee has been sort of cowering away. His emaciated body has not really allowed him to participate in this conflict in any way. But you see an immediate change in his demeanor once he's been struck by the energy field. He almost jerks back and gets a strange, far-off look in his eyes, stands up straighter than you've seen him in this entire time, and you think his eyes have changed color. They're not green anymore. They have this sort of strange, bleeding, orange-red color. He reaches out a hand, and a great gout of flame erupts from it in the direction of one of the far-off Klingons.
Oh, is he a Paw Wraith? Oh, please, God.
All right. I'm going to say, for sake of argument, that your gout of flame strikes one of the Becks and incinerates him immediately. And because I find it funny, the only remaining Klingon on the field sees this, kind of weighs the odds, says, nope, and just turns and leaves through a door.
The honor.
Yeah, you guys are now out of combat.
Well, well, well. Aren't we full of secrets?
Oh, no, Lee has no secrets whatsoever. Commodore Archuleta, Corporal, your hierarchical systems are just nonsensical.
She's just gonna blink off in the distance.
Yeah, remind me to shove you again.
That guy just shoot fire out of his hands?
You're injured.
Yes. Al?
You're smiling.
Would you like some assistance, Parasite?
Does pain not? Whatever. Yeah, I'm not really sure what's wrong with this thing, but if you could fix it, that'd be great.
Bree's like, I'll fix it, and she aims for your head.
I'd rather not, Corporal. I mean, make it worth it at least. Don't shoot me while I'm on the ground.
There's
her
no
boot,
need
her
to.
Her boot's kind of on your neck, and she goes, eh. And she like steps back and reaches a hand out.
We have a hate-hate relationship.
He likes it. I don't know.
So what's the secret, Lee? Thermal plasma ejectors?
Lee is not here any longer, I'm afraid. That little explosion, your incompetence. What was your name again? He turns to Matic. No, it doesn't matter. That little incident. Let's say that it reawakened me after our encounter with the Orb of Madness. You can call me Costamogen.
What the fuck's an Orb of Madness?
The fuck's a Costamogen?
This is really not the time to have this kind of conversation. We have much greater concerns, I think. Shall we away?
I'm still down here.
Yeah, why don't you go first?
You can pick me up and plug me into a computer. That might
Yeah, we gotta heal you. Fuck. Okay.
Yeah, I was gonna say someone, and by someone I mean literally anyone. I need a daring medicine difficulty of one.
That would probably be me. Does anyone have medicine other than me?
Not
me.
I heal myself.
And the nanoprobes could do it. Give me an hour, but I don't have an hour, so.
Hey, there we go. So one success, which means you finally have a momentum again. Yeah. So Tobin, I'll let you flavor how you get Vassar back up.
I will actually lean over him, place my hand over the wound, and essentially cauterize it. But there's a strange, almost healing effect as the flesh begins to regrow as the flames from my hand wash over it.
That's a hell of a buzz. All right.
Let's fucking go.
Pull myself up, dust myself off, grab my bat lift.
It's at this point that Ensign Thomas comes from behind you. I'm coming with you guys, right?
Yes.
Who the fuck are you?
Cannon fodder.
Okay, I don't like that term, but hey, if it keeps me safe, whatever.
That's the opposite of cannon fodder, pal.
Listen, I don't do the words.
All right.
That's fair.
You do anything?
Apparently, I ripped my shirt, and he rips his shirt again.
What?
Does he just have the collar on now?
Yeah, there's just the collar and like just sleeves. Bare chest.
Or no, it's a sleeveless uniform.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, he does have a collar. So it's one of the episodes where Kirk
he has the collar, the thread going to where the sleeve is here, then the thread going to this sleeve. That's all he has left.
Well, either way, however you would like to imagine this Kirk-like man. He's following you around for the time.
Oh, he is not Kirk. Like, don't be crazy.
So, where are you guys headed?
Sar?
I would recommend that we go to the transporter room three decks up and beam onto the bridge. It'll surprise them and we'll be able to get an advantage.
I previously served as an engineer with the Borg technology within me. We should be able to assist you in your transporting.
Excellent. And Williams is just going to reach over and take the disruptor from the. I'll take this.
You know, we might want to shoot him a couple of times. He can get a force field up, and then he can just go first all the time. You know.
Yep. Take turns.
Can you actually analyze the frequencies without us shooting you?
We should be able to determine what frequency to place the force fields on upon examination of bodies that have previously been injured by them. Unit has acquired some abilities and has adopted the name Tempest from the Latin Terran words.
All the languages in the universe, and you choose a Terran language. What's your designation?
4 of 5, Unimatrix 14.
All right, Tempest. Away we go.
I think what he's saying is, let's yap zapping.
All right.
William's just going to brandish the disruptor jokingly. he is clearly enjoying.
Can the Terran go first?
Gladly. And he is clearly enjoying himself.
All right. If there's a Batleth hanging around, I will grab that as well.
Well, see, the problem is when Williams killed the two guys, they went over the edge, and then you incinerated another. I guess there is the one that Archuleta shot.
You don't need it. You have flames from your hands.
As subdermal plasma ejectors are out of juice, probably.
Ensign Thomas just says, wait a second. What if he lit the Batleth on fire?
Lee, is it? Here. And I'll just hand him the Batleth that I have because I know I'm useless with it.
Mm. Thank you. That will suffice. Clumsy, though you're human or mortal.
Yeah. Can we go now?
Weapons might be. Like your bodies.
Oh,
enfleshment. It's revolting.
All right. So if I understand your intentions correctly, you want to literally beam onto the bridge. Is that correct?
We're all going to the transporter room.
Yeah, let's go to the transporter room and beam to the bridge.
Wow. Just willy-nilly. Let's do it.
All right.
Let's jump on in.
Let me just readjust some tokens here. So long story short, you get into the transporter room. They're Klingons. They don't have a transporter chief like O'Brien just sitting there. So it's very easy for you to get in, get the transporters working, and beam you where you want to go. And
Tempest will set up on the station and look at the other four. I will transport you 5 to the bridge. And then from there, we should be able to. I could also assist you from here, removing issues that may arise. We all have seen how I do in combat.
I told you we should have shot him with the disruptor on the way over. He'd be fine.
Are you saying you're going to transport enemies off away from us?
Now that's a good idea.
Things easier.
Into space.
I thought that was implied.
What's to stop him from beaming us into space?
You could just transport him and just delete the the pattern?
That's a good question, Williams. Hey, Tempest, what is your purpose?
My purpose is to collect information for the collective.
Oh, he's still
I cannot do that. I cannot do that if we do not survive.
All right.
I don't know if that's true, but can Borgs lie?
Consider us a part of your local collective, and we all get out of this together. You get me?
Fully understood.
Well, geez, what are you going to do if he doesn't comply? You gonna try to fight him or something? You gonna try to hit him with a mat lift?
Yeah, me.
Tempest will look at, will look between them and does somebody choose to stay? And
Thomas.
Thomas does that thing where he goes, okay.
You're staying.
Okay.
He'll be fine. Just rip his shirt a little. It's fine. It's great.
Did someone say? And he does the motion.
Not right now. You're jumping the gun.
Wait, no, that's a code for something else entirely. I mean, if you want to do that here.
Betrayal.
All right, can we just go?
Yeah, let's just, yeah.
All right. So, Tempest, you are beaming Archuleta, Lee, Vassar, and Williams to the bridge while you and Thomas stay behind, if I have that correct?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so we will get back to Matic and Thomas in a moment, Tempest and Thomas in a moment. As we cut to a Klingon bridge, actually in rather disrepair, the sort of panels, I hesitate to even call them panels, the pylons that are omnipresent throughout the Klingon bridge, some of them have shattered, broken in places. There are bodies slumped over consoles. There is some form of an atmospheric dispenser that is discharging an appropriate amount of fog and smoke effect into the area. And really, what strikes you as odd is that amidst all of this chaos, amidst all of this damage and otherwise not hospitable to normal individuals, a sort of environment, is a very calm-looking Klingon. He's just sort of seated in the captain's chair, and as you materialize around him, he just sort of looks around at you, says, "I see. So, my enemies have finally caught up to me, is it? Well, I'm not going to go down without a fight."
How calm is he for a Klingon captain?
Extremely. As in, abnormally so.
Sounds to me like you've accepted your fate.
No. See, I think he'll understand once you become one of us.
He's got a bug.
As Archuleta dies. So we are going to go into combat, and I'm going to spend threat to make Mr. Mukvar, son of Koloth, go first. So.
Okay, wait a second.
Yes.
One advance, one momentum, and one threat to have where an open call line is established.
Mm-hmm.
And then if they alert Tempest, I will give you 6 threat just to roll to try to, dematerialize him, but leave like a hand or something.
Okay.
The queen.
Make this a short game.
Yeah, this could be a short game.
No, that's not fun. Let us slice and dice a little bit.
Yeah, I'll say that the key word I have there is when they ask for it.
Right.
Sure. So yes, let's just say it is on the table anything. That if you guys start getting your asses handed to you, you just have to call for help.
Have we recovered stress, by the way?
Yes, all of you have recovered stress. You back up to full stress. But yes, Mr. Mukvar is going to go first. And Mukvar is going to go for Williams. And the way he does it is, again, with unnatural grace for a Klingon, rises from his chair, jumps over one of the fallen pylons, and sort of sweeps one of his palms towards your mouth, and you realize all too late that coming out of a hole in his palm is one of those spider things. So, Williams, I need you to roll me a daring security.
Okay.
I'm not going to roll until you roll for dramatic tension, but just know that the Beck is rolling, or that Mukvar is rolling four dice here.
All right. You give yourself, let's see. All right, I'm going to want to roll four, too. So you give yourself two threat.
Okay.
Okay.
I mean, I believe. Four successes, a moderate amount. Unfortunately, that is five successes. So, Williams. You have the unnerving and just disturbing sensation of a spider-like being trying to crawl into your throat. And what I'm going to say is that on your turn, you need to perform a fitness and security. And if you fail that fitness security, you swap sides.
All right. Cool. And I'm just going to just emote as he just sort of slaps the spider into Williams, but just like, what the fuck? As the spider. Oh, spiders in your mouth. Oh, okay. I'm good. Eight. I'm fine.
Bite
I'm good.
Down.
I'm good. I'm going to eat it.
All right. Well, it is either Archuleta, Vassar, Lee, or Williams's turn.
Could I use my Power Wraith powers to consume the spider, Williams, and the Klingon in a gout of flame?
Yeah, you bastard.
Yeah, I would say that...
arson. It's a great day for arson.
Yeah, I would say that this can happen. But what I would say is, based on the angle, is if you roll a complication, and I will spend some threat to make it a 16 to 20, if you roll a complication, you will hit Vassar.
He'll just transfer to a body. He'll be fine.
All right, so Lee, I need you to roll me a, let's call this a control, and either a science or a security.
Okay.
And the difficulty on this is a 2. But because I have so much threat, I'm going to spend another 2 threat to raise that difficulty to a 3.
Okay. I'm going to try to sell you on something here. Okay. Would my philosophy focus apply, considering that this is not actually an attack? It is an element of worship of the Power Wraiths, mm-hmm. and my understanding of the intricacies of their relationships with the Bajoran people and the cult of the Power Wraiths is part of my discipline of philosophy.
If you give us a traditional a Bajoran chant, I will allow it.
Tova Kostamogen, something, I don't know.
Close enough.
Oh. I mean, that's good. That's
close enough. Oh.
Okay, and I'll buy an extra die.
Okay.
So, control and science, 3d20.
Okay, so good news, you get one momentum. Bad news, there is a complication on the field, and I did say the complication would include Vassar. So, I need you now to roll me 9 challenge die, Lee.
If you die, you should go into the Klingon's body.
I'm so uploading myself to the Klingon ship.
So, Lee, that's 7 damage on the field. Would you like to re-roll those zeros?
Yes, I think I'd like to spend 1 threat to re-roll those 4 zeros.
Okay.
My friends, it has been nice knowing you. This is going to be amazing.
I hope.
So that is 9 challenge or 9 damage. No, sorry, because it's vicious, because it's fire. That is 11, 12 damage. Vassar, I think you're toast.
Do you know what the worst thing about being an entity that gets off on pain is? Fire sears the nerve endings, you jerk! I don't have to feel anything.
Oh, dear. So, Maddox, to answer your question, I think that has solved itself. Vassar, as a gout of flame emits from Lee, you don't feel anything because, as you just said, the nerve endings get seared and... Unfortunately, it's not satisfying, But yeah, unfortunately, Vassar is bye-bye. In terms of Williams, I mean, and I guess I could offer this to Vassar too, but Vassar would have to give me 4 threat to stay up, whereas Williams would just have to give me 2.
I'm alive. I'm just very badly burned.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll give you the 2 threat.
Okay. And yeah, Vassar, to be fair, would you like to stay up? It would just cost 4 threat.
I'm okay with dying.
You're okay with dying. Alrighty. So Vassar is off the field. Williams has been extremely burned. Some would say 4th degree burns. As for Mukhvar, though, Mukhvar doesn't really seem to care. In fact, Mukhvar just sort of looks as if he's wreathed in flame and just sort of turns and begins laughing maniacally.
Fuck.
Sorry. Fascinating.
Also, Dag, you ruined the webcams.
Sorry.
It's okay.
Click the wrong
You see
button.
The last one anyway?
Oh, I'm Vassar now.
No,
yeah,
I'm
you're Vassar now.
Okay.
We could just leave it like that. Everybody knows who you're playing. We're fine. All right. So up next, it's either Williams or Archuleta, because you two are the only ones remaining up.
Lee Tobin isn't?
Well, Lee just went.
Oh, right. Okay. You're really close, Williams. Do you want to go?
Yeah. Yeah, all right. Here. Great. Yep. I'm going to use my minor act to get a little distance between me and Mokbar, just in case Toasty Mojin there just wants to burn me again.
Well, first, we need to handle your fitness security. I will give you an extra die, thanks to Lee Tobin's purification of fire. But I do need to see a fitness security. I'm going to spend 6 threat. The difficulty is a 4.
All right, I'm going to give you... So if you're giving me an extra die, then I need... Let's see, to give you... I think it's 4 threat to get an additional 2 dice to make it 5.
Yes. No, it's 5 threat.
All right, take it.
Before you do that, do you have a value that you could tap instead?
Oh, you know what? That's a great point. I am going to... I do, but can I use a... Can I use a mirror universe value?
You certainly can.
I just, all right. I have a mirror universe value called Alien Slime. Something along that line. Just, he doesn't like aliens.
I gathered.
Only parents. He doesn't even really like those. But all right. I'm going to tap that for
2. All right. So it would cost only 3 threat to get that last die.
Yeah. All right. So we'll do that. Would my survival focus come into play here?
I'll let it happen.
Oh.
Okay, so that is 5 successes, which is enough. However, there is a complication. The complication is that though you are not taken over by the spider bug thing, whatever the hell it is, the complication is that you are stuck where you are because as you look down at your legs... Yeah, those aren't legs anymore. Those are bone. Like, no muscle, nothing. Bone.
Lee burned my legs off?
Lee burned your legs off.
All right. Okay, this is fine. I'll get some new legs. It's fine.
But you could still act. You just can't move.
All right. I am going to act. I'm going to shoot Mr. Mokfer, son of Koloth, with my disruptor pistol.
Okay.
So that's, I believe that's control security.
Control security, difficulty of 2.
Cool. Difficulty 2 there. And I know it's not technically a hand phaser, but I've got hand phasers as a focus.
I'll let it happen. It's ubiquitous enough. Two is all you need, and you get the two. So that's a challenge die, please. So that is 9, 10, 11, 12. Would you like to spend any momentum to reroll? Any momentum to resistance?
No, because I have another thing that I want to do that's going to require that momentum.
Okay.
What's the, sorry, GM, how much momentum does it take if I use the swift task momentum spend to make a second attack?
Two.
Can I give you a point of threat and use the point
you
of
can.
Threat?
You
can. Okay. I'm going to do that because I have fire at will. Okay. So I don't, the difficulty does not increase for me to do this. So I'm going to try to shoot him again.
All right. Go ahead and try to shoot him again.
Oh dear.
I think I'm going to let you hit. Go ahead and roll some damage, but something's going to happen. Good. Okay.
Can I give you a point of threat to reroll those zeros?
Okay.
Might as well, right?
Yeah, can't hurt. All right. So, you discharge your disruptor. You double tap this creature, and it reels as if the disruptor fire does perhaps more damage than the fire did, which is strange. But the complication is that as the disruptor bolt hits him, it sort of grazes him, or at least the second shot does, it grazes him and hits one of the bridge consoles. And as a result, the bridge console begins to explode. But it doesn't stop there. In fact, all of you realize far too late that the entire ship is detonating. And our final scene for our little Mirrorverse session is in a science lab. Let me clean up some tokens here. Materializing in the science lab is a certain Mr. Medic and a certain Mr. Ensign Thomas. And as Ensign Thomas and Matic materialize, Ensign Thomas just kind of looks around and says, "Why the hell did you come rescue me again? I'm not worth it, man. I'm just Jensen's cousin."
Being Jensen's cousin, you still have... Would you even have the... First off... computer, one shirt, human, male, what? Large. He'll shirt will materialize, he'll toss that on, put that on, and stop ripping the fucking
shirts. Trust me. I just thought the shirt ripping thing was, you had to do it.
Just.
I'm putting it on.
So, being Jensen's cousin, Jensen alerted us whenever you went. Jensen had alerted us to some communique you had sent, similar to a communique that a louse had received whenever I was on the Arcadia. I guess apparently you have a way to communicate with us through the Mirror Universe if you come from the Prime Universe. I don't know. But because of your bloodline and the aptitude for temporal research, I found it a personal prerogative that the Daystrom Institute found reason to encourage your rescue.
Well, I'm certainly not going to look a gift horse in the mouth.
Well, I mean, if you want to go back, it can be arranged, but first off, I need to get out of this fucking Borg shit, and you go deal with your cousin. He's probably in med bay again.
Hold on one second. He rips his shirt again, takes out a makeup kit, dabs on a few bruises, maybe even, you know, gives himself a black eye and he says, I'm ready.
Okay. Matic will walk over and he'll just put one, he'll put his one hand on his shoulder and kind of look. It's like, yeah, those are some pretty good bruises. And then he's just going to sock him as hard as he can in the ribs.
He doubles over like, why did you do that?
I don't know what you're talking about. You hit the railing on the ship over across.
Oh God, I think I'm gonna right onto your shoes. And it is with that, with Matic just looking down at his now ruined shoes, that we zoom out of the Fenrir and we see the USS Fenrir just sort of floating by in space. That's where we end our little Mirrorverse escapade.
Fun.
That was fantastic. Freaking lead to open with the pirate. Oh my God.
You did so many twists. You didn't tell. Oh. It was Matic the whole time.
Oh no. As soon as you said, how do we know he's not just going to space us? I'm like, fuck.
Yeah, I was going to say, Matic was like typing a message to me and I saw him stop and he's like, fuck.
Fuck. But then I'm like, okay, well, one of y'all can stay. Thomas can stay. All right.
Yeah, like, so if you didn't catch it, like, his job was to get Thomas back. So.
Oh my God, perfect. It's a fucking movie. That's
and the best part is that Dag and Archuleta, like, Watney and Dag, you guys dropped some, like, very ironic statements like, oh, let's just use nanoprobes, or, oh, let's just shoot him a few times. His implants were fake. He was just banking on the fact you weren't going to test him.
Oh, he died.
That's so good.
Dag, you're muted.
And then I didn't know exactly how, like, another part of it was I had to destroy Mirror Vassar somehow.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think that just deleting the pattern would work. And so I had set up a bomb to go off in the warp core that was cascading through the ship.
Yep. He literally transported a torpedo into the warp core.
So who set up the EPS failure at the
brig? That is a mystery, which, you know, maybe if we ever come back to the Mirror Universe, you might find out.
Yeah, there's 31 reasons as to why it was set up, all right? 31.
We didn't see the ship explode on camera.
This is
so
true.
The Terran Resistance has backup copies. It's fine.
And the Par Wraith is perfectly fine. I mean, Lee's dead, but
yeah, Par
Wraith. He wasn't driving at the end anyways.
Lee gave his life in service to the Par Wraith. It's the highest honor.
It is. It really is.
He probably hates it.
Actually, if Lee was a staunch, atheist, then I feel like he probably wouldn't find too many things more personally profane than to be hijacked by something that claims to be a god.
This is true.
I thought that was the twist. That he was faking the staunch atheism and that he was actually a hardcore prophet, worshiper.
Mm-hmm.
Did this come about because of the idea that we were kicking around that you were going to have been forced to have an orb experience?
No, actually, it was something I talked with ELH about right from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's... And you just kept us in the dark. Fantastic. Oh, so
yeah, I want to say I gave secret objectives to pretty much everyone but Dag and Watney because I found it funny. Because I wanted to see if Watney and Dag would catch on. And again, you guys, again, said some very ironic things.
Yeah,
you were
yeah.
This close. This close.
What was William's secret thing?
Never mind.
No, tell us. Tell the audience. They're watching.
We're the ones being tricked, so.
You don't have to. No, basically, I had foreknowledge of the captain level locket. Yeah.
Part two, Williams Boogaloo.
On the shuttle bay, and I was gonna go, but I wasn't necessarily gonna take you guys with me.
So should have just followed my instinct there and been like,
oh, you're not getting paid at all.
It should have been like, hey, drone, it's set to 402 megahertz.
Yup.
Yeah, that'd be fantastic.
Now it's set to, why are you on the ground? Get up.
Well, just keep shooting him.
That's blood.
The other thing that I think is pretty nice is I was actually, like, after combat had ended, accidentally set off the weapon in an area attack to hurt everybody. It just so happened that I rolled the complication. I'm like, all right, cool. We'll roll with it. Fuck it.
Yeah, that was not planned, by the way. Like, that was entirely the dice.
I guess you could say Tempest fuck it.
Oh, God. And on that note, that's where I'm going to cut the stream. So Twitch, YouTube, thank you so much for tuning in for this episode of Fenrir. We are back with Season 2 next week on the 17th, usual time. Till then, live long and prosper. Later, stream.
Oh, fuck.